Good morning. I'm very impressed to see these many young people. And I must admit, I'm also very impressed how many young ladies are within you who are part of this high educational school and ultimately would like to study maybe even physics or mathematics or engineering. I don't know exactly. My name is Fritz Wagner. I was introduced. The first time I was in Russia was 1975. I still then was a young man. Things have changed in between. I have often been to St. Petersburg, but I have also been, of course, to Moscow. I was in Novosibirsk. I was in Tashkent. This was, of course, then the Soviet time. I was in Samarkand. And even in other places, I forgot. I always enjoy being here. And now the situation is that I will be here in St. Petersburg for 4 months this year and 4 months next year. So this is, of course, a great opportunity to learn more about St. Petersburg and its wonderful culture in this city. Yesterday I have been to a performance of Balonin. Who knows Balonin? One, only one. Two, three, four, five. Wonderful. Okay. Okay, so good. Those who don't know him, I think you should better go to one of these performances. It is just wonderful. But don't sit in the first five rows, because people are very much integrated there. I have to give my talk in English, despite the fact that I have so frequently been to Russia. I apologize for this, but I'm too old to learn Russian. Now, in case you have problems with my English, please let me know. I will try to speak slow, but often I forget. Can you understand what I'm telling you? Good. Okay, so let's start. Thank you for the invitation. I'm quite happy that I can talk about my research field. And this research field is plasma physics, and a specialty in this field, which is fusion research. And fusion research has always been a very dominating field, originally in the Soviet Union, now in Russia. This will also become partly clear from my talk. So the title of my talk is Fusion and Magnetic Confinement of High Temperature Plasmas. So there are three terms I have to explain. I have to explain fusion, magnetic confinement, and plasmas. So fusion is an important process in nature. It is the melting, the fusion of light elements to heavier elements. This is like building a house. You have bricks and stones, and you add them up, and suddenly there's a wall, and then there's a house. So out of a small building part, you are building something new and larger one. So the most important fusion process is the fusion process which happens in the core of the Sun. And this is ultimately the fusion of four protons to helium. So here you can see this process. There are four protons, H, and they ultimately give helium. And this is the dominant process which happens in the Sun. It is not so simple as I have shown it here. What I have shown here is the net product of a chain reaction, which is called the PP cycle. The fusion, the PP fusion cycle inside the Sun. And helium is the outcome of a fusion reaction. And the Sun is already enriched with helium. It has already 30% or something like this helium in its inner part. And helium, Helios, the sun god, these things hang together because people discovered spectroscopically helium is indeed inside the sun. So this is the fusion process which does not stop with helium. It continues, and I will just explain a little bit on this. Now the next term is, I have to explain, is plasma. So this is the fourth state of matter. And I will say in my next few graph a little bit more to this. And ultimately, magnetic confinement. This is the story of my talk. So most of my talk will deal with the physics of magnetic confinement, and you will learn what I mean thereby. So, coming back to plasma, it is, as I said, the fourth state of matter. The first one is the solid state, this here, the table. The second one is the liquid. The third one is the gas. And you can see, of course, and know that when you heat things up, and you can see the arrow of the temperature there, then the state changes. So at low temperature, and this can be an ambient temperature for metal or wood, it is solid state. But now when you heat it up, for example, ice will melt at 0 degrees. When you further heat it up, then it will become gas at 100 degrees. So there is sort of a competitional element between the thermal energy which you introduce and the binding energy which keeps things together. So when the thermal energy is larger than the binding energy of solid, of ice for example, then it melts. Now when you heat it further up and you change sort of the kinetics of the close ordering in a liquid, then it becomes a gas. So it is always a decomposition process which makes out of a solid a liquid a gas. And the next decomposition process now affects the molecular and atomic species of a gas and decomposes this. And what are the elementary parts which compose ultimately an atom? This is the nucleus and the electrons around it. So when we heat up the material even further, then the electrons disappear. They are not connected any longer to the nucleus. And now the new gas, which has free electrons and naked nuclei, this is called a plasma. So you can see here once more the development of the four states of matter, starting from a solid state here, up to ultimately going to the plasma. And this should show here, for example, maybe if it is a hydrogen plasma, the protons and the electrons. And you understand what I mean. So plasmas are very ambient in nature. And the sun is a plasma. Also the sun corona is a plasma. And you can see it here during an eclipse. Then the aurora, the northern lights, is a strong interaction of the solar winds with the ionosphere, with the atmosphere of the Earth, and this produces then plasmas. Then here you can see an example of the stars in the sky in the night, and all the stars plasmas. And here is a special case where a star explodes in a supernova, and then for example a lightning, again the channel of a lightning is a plasma. So plasmas are very ambient, and in all these cases matter is sort of dissolved into the nuclei and the electron. And you can also see that this state strongly interacts because all of these plasmas are radiating light intensively. So this is sort of one side of plasmas. How do they appear in nature? And we have learned to utilize the specific properties of plasmas and employ them, use them for many technical cases. So these are technical plasmas. So for example, you can make tissue. Where is my arrow? Okay, so on the left upper side you can see tissue which is specifically prepared in its surface so that it does not absorb water, just the opposite. It is hydrophobic. So this is of course very good for clothes in the rain. Then the next, you can see yourself, it's a turbine. And the blades are exposed to very strong interaction with the air. And in order for them to live for a longer time, they are treated, the surface is treated with plasmas. Then the next is a big plasma screen, how in a way one can nowadays shop them. Then the left downside shows you a surface which is manipulated, it is etched and structured, and this is nowadays very important. And of course important is to make this as small as possible, and plasma processes allow you to do this. Then the next is a lamp. I have already mentioned plasmas produce light, and in nowadays cars, whenever the light is a little bit blue, these are high pressure plasma lamps. And ultimately what you can see here is a tokamak, a fusion device, and I will talk a little bit about this more. This is a cartoon of ITER, the International Thermonuclear Reactor, experimental reactor. And this also, of course, is a technical use of plasmas. Okay, before I now start with my first still introductory topic, fusion is the energy source of the world, the universe. Let me ask you, is it clear with my English? Okay. And also, you can hear me in the back? Can you hear me in the back? Okay. Okay, so I would like to briefly talk about fusion as the energy source of the universe. What happens in the sun and where the solar energy comes from was always a miracle for mankind. You know it yourself, ancient people already prayed to the sun. And the question, of course, then was, where does the energy come from? And people calculated, okay, maybe the sun is a big stove and it's burning coal, how long would it last? And then the calculation shows it only would last for 5,000 years, something like this. And we know that our planetary system is much older. Do you know how old it is? How old is our planetary system? Hmm? Who has an idea? Hmm? Mm-hmm. So it is 4.3 billion years. Our planetary system. This is sort of the estimate at the moment. So it's much older than the outcome of this calculation. Then people thought, okay, maybe it's gravitational energy. The sun gradually collapses. Again, going through the calculation shows the time it would burn is much shorter than the 4.3 billion years. And then in the beginning of last century, people recognized it is the fusion process, which I mentioned already, the PP cycle, that hydrogen ultimately fuses to helium. And what happens in the sun? Oh, okay, great. Okay, so somebody, okay, excellent, thanks a lot. So in the sun, ultimately hydrogen is, I told you, is converted to helium, and per second, 600 million tons of hydrogen matter is transferred into 596 million tons of helium. And this is the fusion process which I mentioned before. And you can see the difference there of 4 million tons per second. And this is now transformed into energy utilizing this person's most famous formula. Who is this? Great. This is Albert Einstein, and this is the relation between energy and matter. Matter can be changed into energy, and a kilogram gives a tremendous amount of energy because this is the velocity of light, which is a large figure in our unit, and this is squared. So this is the conversion of mass into energy. Also, the other process is possible to transfer energy into mass. And what the sun is doing, it produces thereby 3.6 times 10 to 17 gigawatt of power, which radiates and a little fraction we get. Okay, here you can see the plasma as a sun with a strong eruption here. And you can see that this eruption is a little arch, and maybe you can see this arch is even in its shape a little bit helical. So this is sort of something the sun is doing by itself. And from this energy, as I said, we only get a little fraction, 1.4 kilowatt per square meter outside the atmosphere. And this is the energy which reaches the sun. So far the story about how the fusion process produces the necessary energy throughout the universe, because what happens in the sun happens also in one or the other form in all the stars. But in addition, the fusion process is also in charge to give us the material variety which we have in our universe. And you know this table, of course. Here you can see hydrogen, helium, and lithium. And this is sort of the raw material which is produced and given to us by the Big Bang process, whatever this in detail is. As you know, initially the universe and the definition of space and time started with the Big Bang. Now I ask you, how old is our planetary system? The next question would be, when happened the Big Bang, according to as much as we know? And this is now the age of the universe. And this is 14 billion years, 14 point something, 3 or 7 billion years. There was the Big Bang, and as a consequence, these elements were produced. But now, when we look into fusion, and I mentioned that out of hydrogen we are producing more helium, then ultimately fusion produces all these elements. And I show you in a minute what is the background of this production. So we have to be very grateful to this natural process, this basic process, because it delivers us many elements, let me say, up to iron. And of course it's clear which role iron plays in our civilization. Now when one looks at the rest, where does it come from? This is not the story of my talk, but this happens then inside, also inside the stars. Also this happens, as we have seen in the case of the sun inside the star. And this happens whenever supernova explosions occur. Under these circumstances, there is a very intense neutron flux, and in this case, these additional elements are produced. So the basic rule which governs the production of elements is the binding energy, which is shown here against the nucleus number. So here we have hydrogen, and here we have uranium. And this is the binding energy. And you can of course see that very subtle physics governs this. For example, helium here sits isolated, rather strongly bound. And then you can see carbon, oxygen, up to iron. At iron, we have the maximum of the binding energy. So this is a very fundamental curve which regulates basically many aspects of life which we now have. And you can also see how nature prepared the situation that the binding of protons into helium is a very exceptional situation.